Baseball is dead.
Rest in peace.
Allergies are kicking my ass today.
Oh, those, the Dutch elm.
The Dutch beetle. Man, I woke up this morning. I was like, am I sick? No. You blow your nose. It's all clear. And you're like, all right, it's allergies. That's how you know.
Who is it, Jayhay? Yoko, the Dutch beetle, is bringing him down.
Yeah, invasive that's, species.
That's mm-hmm. that's a tough scene. Tough scene. Hot shower, Jared. Hot shower.
Do you get allergies on the West Coast? Do you have trees?
Yeah, we got trees on the West Coast for sure. We got grass on the West Coast. Yeah, that's really what can get you if you're not prepared is the grass on the West Coast, Jared.
Three more days till the anniversary of the day that my soul almost left my body. Because of Dallas Braden celebrating 420. That'd be 5 years, right?
Yeah.
That was 2019?
Yeah.
Or 18. No, that was 18? That was 18.
18.
Yeah, so 6 years. Yeah.
18.
Yeah.
What do you
Jayhay was there.
Yeah, Jayhay, what do you have planned for 420? You have plans for 420? Where are you gonna be? You gonna be on a beach somewhere?
Yeah, I'm actually gonna be in Miami.
Oh, look at you.
Not really in any way celebrating 420 in the traditional sense that you're referring to, but I will be, I will be celebrating. I will be enjoying myself.
No, yeah, I got you flip flops, board shorts, bad Hawaiian button up, SPF 70 somewhere lathered all over your face and ears, kind of a Miami trip with the family, right? Is that accurate?
Mm. Mm. I mean, you're painting a picture that makes me sound like a loser, kind of a dork.
No,
I think I'm more the type of guy who will be like, wow, Miami. No, that guy
cabana pants,
Miami. Yeah,
cabana pants and an open linen shirt with a fedora.
Yeah, really lean into it for the basically 50 hours that I'll be there.
In and out. Well, I'll be in Cleveland. I'll be in Cleveland, Ohio. Woo! For 420.
You guys are playing each other again?
Cannabis enthusiasts out there in Cleveland, Ohio. Yeah, we are. We are playing the Guards again.
Schedule makers fucking love this podcast. They're like, we need Dallas and Jayhay head to head six times before we get to
early. Early.
Yeah, yeah, really lean into it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. April's a little slow. Give us that Jayhay and Dallas head to head competition.
Yeah. Right out the gate. Ratings magic.
Yeah. And a four game series in Boston. Go kick their dicks in for four games.
The scheduling is not over. Scheduling is not ideal. We don't play. We haven't played the Halos. We still have not played the Halos.
Oh, please.
And we're not going to play.
Scheduling is not. We started with a fucking 10 game West Coast road trip. Came back 7-3. Haven't won a game since, pretty much.
Nobody's talking about the Red Sox right now. We're talking about the A's and we're talking about our terrible schedule and how things have lined up. That's what we were talking about.
Oh, my schedule. Oh, my real schedule.
On top of traveling the second most in baseball, we continue to get boned on the scheduling. Like, it is what it is. That's
so
what we do.
Move to Sacramento, how is that going to affect your distinction of being the most traveled team in the league? Is that still going to be a thing or no?
Yeah. It's just about 35 minutes inland from where they're at right now.
Oh, what about Vegas? How's that going to impact the travel?
Well, that's a little farther inland, as you can tell. You start getting a little more towards the middle of the country. So that starts to cut into travel time. So it could very well start to lean towards the Dodgers, the Angels, and the Mariners, Giants. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Speaking of the Dodgers, some good baseball last night. Mookie Betts went 5-for-5. But the thing that stood out to me about Mookie Betts' performance last night, I don't know if you watched the game, probably not. I know, Dallas, you were on the air. Jayhay, I don't know if you caught any of it. Mookie Betts at shortstop. Like, guy thinks he's Nomar Garciaparra. Like, come on. There was one play where he's going to his right.
Wait, what
and
is
he? Tries to do the Nomar.
Tries to do a backhand?
Like, he tried to do like the Nomar jump throw and like fucking seven hopped it to first base.
That's happened a couple times then.
Offline.
That's happened a couple of times because I saw it early too, and I thought to myself, I was like, I had that going a lot better in my head. Like I had him.
Well, he's got a great arm.
Oh, well, that's what I mean. Is I had him sizing that ball up, and I was like, okay, that looks good. And like he even started to come around it, come through with the backhand. But then, like, just the I don't know if it was a stumble or just like maybe like not completely comfortable on his feet at that moment, and it was an errant throw.
Yeah.
But do we, Jared, you and I both talked about this, and it's not like we were the only ones. I think we all kind of entertained this notion. But do you think that there's going to be a moment, because it doesn't appear so, we're talking about the Nomar jump throw not executed on a night where he went 5 for 5. Does it appear that there's going to be any of that let down offensively because of the demand defensively, or
no?
Is it just too soon?
No, I don't think it's too soon. I think because he came out of the gate so hot that if he does go through a slump, you're not going to be able to point to playing shortstop as a reason why.
That's fair. I think that there could probably be, if there are defensive miscues, I think that would be the only thing that you could start to say or start to correlate. Because you could say that they're both starting to go south, and maybe if the demand of him having to range to his left and right and do everything that he has to do,
well, you're implying that like he would be like in his own head and thinking about it, but like he doesn't have a ton going on in there.
Well, what I think would be the case is him saying, "So fucking hateful."
Well, I'm just saying, he's not the brightest bulb. He's not.
I get it. You didn't get to go to the Candlepin bowling tournament. I understand.
I'm just saying.
Yeah, I just wonder if we get to that certain point in time, do the Dodgers start to entertain the possibility of moving him or trying to alleviate?
Wow, you wanted them to trade Mookie.
No, where would you
see him going?
I mean, moving him.
Where do you
around?
Think is like the best fit? Like, who needs a shortstop right fielder that is a hitting 383 right now, which, by the way, did you see Bo Bichette's comments? And he was asked, you know, what's the most important statistic? And he said batting average. And I think we all know that that's not true, but just more so your takes on that line of thinking that batting average is the most important statistic.
I think it is insight to the
evolution, to
his game and what he is, I guess, valuing, obviously, because he's put that at the top of his list, or at least that was his comment. I think at times those opinions come from a deeper place. Like, what does he want to see? What kind of player is he? Right? He's not a guy who is necessarily going to be overvalued because of his power prowess. Like, that's not who you're going to lock in on Bo Bichette for. You're going to lock in on him, hopefully, with his ability to put the bat on the ball frequently. And because he can do that, he can find his way on base frequently. So that's why he starts to value batting average, because he's like, yo, I can put the ball in play. I can get to pitches. Good things happen when that happens. And I'm a good player. So that's why I'm going to value batting average, because this is something that I do well. This is something that I have this is the tool that I have. And I think with how we've talked about players evolving and the game evolving to value these players more and more, then I can see why there might be a sort of a come around, you know, because when OPS, like when guys like Joe figured out that it was like on base and slugging, you just add those together and you're like, holy shit.
Yeah.
So when that happened, you started to figure out a different way to value guys. We've talked about weighted runs created. We've talked about, you know, WOBA, expected batting average. Like, there's a lot of different ways that guys, I think, start to value and analyze themselves. And I mean, look, dude, in all honesty, if that's what has him locked in to go to work, believe it. That's what I want you selling out to. That's fine. Because if that's the end result, is a constant competition for a batting title, and it's because you think batting average is the holy grail, and you're on base for us and you're driving and you're scoring run, then fuck, man. What do you want me to tell you?
So, for example, like I still believe, and I still want Jayhay's take on this as well, but I still believe in batting average as a statistic that has value. I want to know it. Like, when I sort of like look at a complete slash line, like I think my eye, like I think I want to know OPS first, but then I want to know the batting average as well. So like this morning,
let me stop you. Let me just to have this, just to work through this conversation. Mm-hmm. Why OPS first?
I want to know damage. because okay, I think damage has more value to me. Like, so the point that I'm getting to here is the stat that I tweeted this morning. Colton Cowser, Ryan O'Hearn, Jordan Westberg, Gunnar Henderson, Ryan Mountcastle, and Adley Rutschman are hitting a combined 315 with a 947 OPS to start the season. So when I took all those players, like, I don't have it in front of me now, but Adley is hitting somewhere around like 315, but his OPS is like in the 700s or something like that. So like, I was thinking, like, if I leave Adley out, the statistic, the group statistic will be more impressive. But if I, like, it'll be over 1,000. But if I keep him in,
the average
315 is still impressive to hit as a group.
As a group.
And 947 is pushing 1,000. And you want Adley's name to be grouped in because he's part of the young, exciting core. But that was kind of my thought process, was like, ooh, I could leave Adley out of this group and then they'd be hitting, you know, 327 with a, you know, 1046 OPS. And like, that's cool because the OPS is over 1,000, but 947 is still a pretty damn good OPS to be hitting as a group of six or seven players.
Yes. Yes. That is extremely solid because you're talking about a body of work. Like, and put it like this, when you start to evaluate groups, and this happens with pitchers, you're starting to go through lineups and you're looking at the totality of their work, and you got a club that comes in and they're fucking hitting 270 as a team. You're like, okay. All right, we can put the bat on the ball, as opposed to a team who, you know, is struggling coming in and hitting 243 as a team. You can look at those numbers right there and tell you, all right, that's not going to tell us the whole story. But on average, it feels like I've got more of a window against a team who's not reaching base on average as much as this other team is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but there's so much. That's the beautiful part about it, is there's so many other statistics that you can dive into to tell you the story that you're looking for.
Yeah, specifically on a triple slash, where do your eyes go first, Jayhay?
OPS. If so we're talking about the end of it, I mean, if we're talking about actually the three parts of a triple slash, then I guess my eyes, I don't really know how to answer that. They go to all of them at the same time. On a triple slash. I mean, if we're being very, very objective about it, plenty of studies to the degree that no more need to be done about what stats correlate to winning baseball games. OPS, slugging percentage, and on-base percentage all correlate much more directly to winning than batting average. Just a fact. So, like, if we're talking about which stat is, do you want to know first? Well, if my goal is to know something about how good the player is, then I need to go to OPS first if those are my options. There are obviously stats that are better than OPS, and those correlate more to winning too. But like, batting average is something I want to know because I like baseball history. We've talked about this before. Like, I put a value on knowing if a guy hits, you know, a Luis Arraez last season. That was fun to track, right? Like, that was... I enjoyed the historical, you know, searching and the context that came with each, you know, as he made his run at 400 or whatever through the first, you know, 2 months of the season. But I also want to know batting average because it can lead me to other things. It can lead me to, well, how what is the relationship between this person's amount of hard contact, is his batting average on balls in play, or the teams, or if this is a team-wide thing, versus where their batting average is. Is there a gap there? What can that gap tell me? So, like, batting average alone, yeah, I want to know it. But as much for what it can tell me about other things as for what it tells me on its own.
So, Jay, yeah. let me ask you guys this. With the triple slash line, do you have numbers, whether they're round or whatever, that you want to see? Because I've always looked at it like
300, 400, 500.
So the batting average, like, the closer the batting average and the OBP are together, obviously you need the batting average to be higher. We're talking 300 plus. Then what do you got?
No, I don't even want, like, I'm not even looking to see something, but like, to your point about whether there's a large gap between the OBP and the batting average or something like that, or a very small gap, like, both of those things are interesting for different reasons, right? Like,
yeah.
You know, Adam Dunn was interesting because there was a 180-point gap between his batting average and his on-base percentage some seasons, right? And then there are other people like Ichiro Suzuki in some seasons was interesting, or maybe more fringe players that Unesky Betancourt was interesting at times because, you know, there was a fractional difference between his batting average and his on-base percentage. And what did that tell us, and how many weeks would he go without walking? You know, it's all different. But to Jared's point, like, if I want to know immediately that a guy's producing at a star level that I don't really need to think a whole lot more about, 300, 400, 500 is a great place to start.
Yep. OPS.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think, you know, there are going to be players that hit 231, but have an 802 OPS. And it's like, all right, what do I think of this player? Is this player good?
Well, look no further than Kyle Schwarber. Like, he didn't hit 200. He did not hit 200. He hit under 200, and he had an OPS north of 800. Mm-hmm. It wasn't 850, right? It was
812 or something.
20 or some shit. I don't know. But yeah, that's a prime example of that. Is you can look at that and what did his triple slash line look like? What, like 199, and then you go to his OBP. I'm sure.
Oh, he made it over 200. I mean, I know we were tracking actually
I'm talking about last year.
He hit 197, 343 on base, and he slugged 474 for an 817 OPS, which is right around his career average. His career OPS is 828, and he had an 817 OPS while hitting 197.
But he's over a 200 hitter career. He's over a 220 hitter career.
226.
Yeah.
I mean, the commentary on Schwarber, at least from my end, isn't that he isn't a person that you want on the team. It's that it is exceedingly unusual for a guy to hit that many home runs and only have an OPS or a slugging percentage that high. Because typically, when you hit 45 homers a season, you are not so exclusively one-dimensional. And like most people who hit 45 homers hit more than like 24 doubles plus triples in a season, or 20 doubles plus triples, which is what he did the last two seasons. And he adds very few singles, which, whatever, we'd rather have the homers. Kyle Schwarber leaning into who he is probably a good thing at this stage, right? He has found more consistency doing what he's doing right now than at any previous point in his career, including what should have been his, like, you know, early prime, right? He was more up and down then than he has been the last two plus seasons, leaning into the all home runs all the time sort of stuff, or home runs and walks all the time.
You know what's interesting to look at, Jayhay, is you go back and his two all-star seasons are one in which he had the highest batting average of his career, and the other is the one in which he hit the second most home runs, but he led the league that year in homers. He also led the league and that year in strikeouts.
Yeah,
and the concern with Schwarber specifically is just that the margin is thin, right? It's thin for different guys for different reasons, but it's thin for him because when he can no longer make contact at an acceptable level, like in terms of like bat to ball contact and driving the ball, like it's going to be over very, very quickly. It was over for Adam Dunn very, very quickly. And Adam Dunn's like peak in terms of on base percentage was in a completely different stratosphere than what Kyle Schwarber has ever done. Kyle Schwarber's career high in on base percentage is 374. Like Adam Dunn's peak was, you know, was like 4 to 5 years of like a 380, 390 on base percentage. So different guys, different value, but.
It's just an interesting
for sure
conversation topic. Yeah. Cause I mean, I don't know. I feel like the newer, like when we had that conversation about the fans who it's almost like they're not even a fan of a team or like the players. They're just like general manager fans.
Yeah.
That's when you start to get into the territory of like batting average doesn't matter at all, which is just, I don't know. I'll never buy into that. Like, I want to know if he's a good hitter. You don't only factor in OPS. Like Kyle Schwarber being the extreme example of, yeah, he's got an 827 OPS, so he's a good hitter. It's like, all right, but he hit 218. It's like, okay, so he's just exclusively hitting homers and walking. Like, it's just you find out what kind of hitter he is.
Well, that's where I think batting average starts to tell a story of combined bat to ball skill and luck, right? Because it tells you that this person is getting the bat to the ball, and they have to do that if they're going to get hits. And if they're going to get hits, that ball has to fall. And we can get into some of the other numbers, like expected batting average and on balls in play, and we can get into exit velocity and barrel percentage and whether or not that these balls should be called hits. There's statistics for that. But the batting average statistic itself broadly paints the picture of bat-to-ball skill combined with luck. And so that's why I think you're interested in it. That's why I think everybody should have some interest in it, because it does, to an extent, tell the story of whether or not a guy is viable. But there's so many other statistics now that can compound that. You don't have to just rely on that simply, because we can look at the numbers and go, Kyle Schwarber, 197? What? 199? And then Jayhay can go, yeah, but power on base turns into opportunities, turns into leading the league in homers, turns into driving 100 runs in. And we all know that that's extremely valuable.
And this is, just as a quick aside, this is why I don't really have time for the people who are like immediately dismissive of wins above replacement, because it's not perfect, or they don't align perfectly all the time. Because here's the problem that you run into when you move beyond this part of the conversation, is that you have, the question was batting average, what does that tell you? OPS, what does that tell you? If you only knew batting average, and then you lined Kyle Schwarber up against Nico Horner, right, just to pull one example of an extreme type, a more extreme type of player, you'd be like, all right, I'll take Nico Horner. Okay, but if then you pull up only the slugging percentage, you'd be like, or home runs or whatever, then I'd be like, oh, well, Kyle Schwarber is like five times the player that Nico Horner is. I'm going to be taking Kyle Schwarber. Of course I am. But then you realize that one of those guys is a DH / bad corner outfielder, and the other guy is a gold glove caliber and at times gold glove winning up the middle defender who is currently playing second base, but probably has the skill set to play shortstop at a similar level if the Cubs needed him to. The metrics back that up from his career. So like, then you go into wins above replacement, and you're like, oh, well, Nico Horner was the better player by some degree last season because he is providing all of this defensive value that wouldn't be captured in any one of these individual stats alone. So like, that's part, again, what makes the game fascinating is like, who would you rather have, this guy who's hitting 47 home runs a season, or would you rather have this guy who's hitting 8 home runs a season, but is delivering up the middle defense at an extremely high level? It's part of what makes the game fascinating.
Aren't you sort of experiencing this as a fan with your franchise, who are trying to not move away from, but, and we've talked about this, almost feels like what the Guardians have done is acknowledge that they've reached their capacity in terms of employing a bat to ball approach offensively and disregarding power from some places. Now they're like, you know what? I think we need a little more of that power. I think we're going to need a little more of that sock. That's why Miles Straw's hanging out in AAA.
I think having Jose Ramirez and building your team around him as your best player on offense is a perfectly viable concept. What I don't think is viable, especially moving forward in his career, is for him to be the biggest home run threat on your team. I don't know whether their budget is ever going to allow them to have these sort of middle of the order threats that I grew up loving following that team. That era is gone. And I just don't think Josh Naylor is ever going to be that sort of player. But you're right that they have recognized that bat to ball will get you so far. And then, you know, you realize that in order to win playoff games, you have to string together 6 straight singles, 3 separate times in a game to win against some of these other teams that will just bludgeon you with an occasional 2 or 3 run homer. So, yeah, that's what it is.
Hasn't been much of a tall task for the Guardians in this series against the Red Sox, by the way. Some wild games last night.
Yeah.
3 of them, in fact, went into extra innings. You had the D-backs and the Cubs that went 10. They're calling them the comebacks. Do you get it?
I don't hate it. It's kind of up my alley. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Instead of the D-backs, Dallas?
Yeah, I got it the first time.
Yep.
The comebacks.
Get it? Yeah, so this is a very back and forth game. You had Ian Happ had a grand slam in this one. The Cubbies, I think, where they were down three, they started chipping away late. You got Ian Happ at the grand slam. You're thinking, man, what an awesome comeback victory for the Chicago Cubs. Did not happen that way. They walk it off in 10. The Angels and Rays last night went 13. I mean, if you were watching this game, it felt like you were watching Game 7 of the World Series. Like, I'm not going to sit here and criticize Major League players for trying so hard, but it was an all-out effort baseball game that I was, as I was watching the Red Sox try to play baseball against the Guardians last night, I had my eye on Angels Rays, and I'm like, man, this game is pretty entertaining. It was very back and forth. There was drama. There was reviews. There was great defense. There was scoring late, lead changes. The Angels Rays game, that was, you know what? I might even throw my stamp on game of the night. Might even throw my stamp on game of the night for Angels Rays last night. And then that brings us to the Red Sox and Guardians game, Jay. What are your thoughts watching my shit ass baseball team? Like, we don't play defense well. No. Yesterday we hit three home runs.
Are you the worst defensive team in baseball right now?
Yes. So we have the most errors in baseball, but not only that, like I'm keeping notes. I said this before. I'm keeping notes on every single game that I watch, and there have been plays. Yeah, I was going to say, like, I would give away the notebook at the end of the year, but no one's going to want it after the season's over. multiple plays this season where it was clearly an error by the Boston Red Sox and it was ruled a hit. So not only do they lead the league in errors, but like it should be more. It should be worse. And the fact that, you know, like I think if you get picked off, that should be an error. Like mental errors should be errors. Like the Red Sox have gotten picked off three or four times in the last three games or something like that. So it's not just defensive errors. There are mental errors. And then something that went under the radar, I don't know if you noticed this last night, Jayhay, in extra innings, there was one out and I believe it was first and third. Ground ball to Valdez and he went to first and the run scored. Like by that point, I think that's what made it like 10-7 like it wasn't like a go ahead run. It was an insurance run, but and no one called him out on this. He definitely thought that there were two outs. So like,
that's
like
a good point. I'm not sure I digested that in the moment because of where the score was and the vibe and stuff like that.
Where the score, but you're also not looking at Valdez as someone like in my notebook. I have written several times, like not sure this guy's ever played baseball before. Like he homered in the game. So like he'll have plays where it's like, man, what a great play. Or he'll like launch a bomb. You're like, damn, that dude can mash. But then other times, like he will just make these mental errors where it doesn't get marked down as an error in the box score. But first and third, one out, a ground ball right to him. It wasn't a slow roller, had all the time in the world to turn a double play, and he just went to first. And that made it 10-7. So, yeah. What are your impressions of my dog shit baseball team, Jay?
Well, I think all of those things are on point. They are a tough watch. But I'm going to go counter to what everybody's expecting. I want to bring a little sunshine to the Red Sox.
Wow.
I want to bring a little bit of sunshine because this is not going to be breaking news for anybody who tunes in for the Section 10 content. But I do think it's worth bringing to a national audience for those who aren't yet aware. But like I was a little late on Casas, and I just like I love watching that guy hit, and
he's fun to watch. Jay, he's a fucking weirdo.
He is. You can tell he's a little weird, and I don't want to the Joey Votto comparison is a little lazy. But there is a little bit of that going on when I watch him hit, or like the next version of Joey Votto. But like, and again, I know Red Sox fans are all over this, but like since May 7th of last season, which is a span of 121 games, okay, to the present, he's hitting 286, 382, 541, which is a 923 OPS with 26 homers. The only present day American League players who have a higher OPS or WOBA, you could use a fancy stat too, same list. The only American League players with a higher OPS over that stretch are Corey Seager, Yordan Alvarez, and Jose Altuve. That's it. Like, this guy has already ascended. If the Red Sox were a better overall team, we would start to have the conversation that this is a down ballot MVP type of player, potentially, depending on how the season goes. Like, and there's nothing about, like, his current OPS, I think, on the season is roughly in the same ballpark of what his OPS ended as at overall last season. But, like, if you look at what he's done since that brutal start to last year, like, to the present, I couldn't be more optimistic, and it seems like there's still growth potential there. I don't know. Like, we could do a whole bit on how shitty the Red Sox are around that, but that is one of the things that stood out to me from a positive end. That's the note that I took.
Wow. I guess it's different for you, because
it is,
you,
for sure.
You are not emotionally invested in the Red Sox wins and losses, so you will just see
not
things, I guess.
Nope.
But I mean, I feel like, you know, if you're a Red Sox fan, you know Tristan Casas, good. Rest of team, bad. Like, that's kind of where we're at right now. But
in terms of physical reactions to that game, though, on the play at home where Stephen Kwan, you know, snuck by and missed the plate and then went mm-hmm. back, I like physically went like this as he like mm. went by, because, you know, you're watching and you're like, I get down, get out of here, you know, like, obviously that was a turning point in the game, but
big time,
big win,
huge win for the guards. Happy for you guys. The first place Cleveland Guardians, but them Kansas City Royals are right up your ass.
Before we move on from the guards real fast, can we just point out that they are also picking first in the upcoming draft?
Oh, there you
have
go.
Have people forgotten about that? Because you remember, it was no longer worst record, right? They did that little lotto deal.
Lottery, yeah.
Yeah.
The Guardians got the first pick. So we're talking about a first place team in the Central and a team with the first overall pick.
It's pretty nice.
And what, all 3 years or however long they've been doing this, the A's have statistically had some of the best odds to get the first pick and have consistently gotten boned.
Perfect timing for the rule to be implemented, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, I think you, Dallas, have gotten boned. Maybe the fans have definitely gotten boned. But, like, the organization, it's like, if you don't try to win, you shouldn't get rewarded for that, which is why it's a great system. Like, John Fisher does not deserve the number one overall pick.
I want to believe that guys in the room deserve to have number one pick teammates.
Sure. Yes. Yeah. I agree. But just, you know, being around the draftees last year, speaking to two of your draftees, Miles Naylor mm-hmm. went to the A's. Mm-hmm. And who was your first round pick? He was a shortstop out of high school.
Jacob Wilson.
Yeah. Yeah. Got to talk to him as well. You know, it's hard.
Who, by the way, Jayhay, you want to have some fun? Just go look at Jacob Wilson and his route to the big leagues, because all that fucking dude does is rake. That's all he does. That's all he does is hit. Just fucking hit.
Mm. Yeah. See, that's where you guys are connected, because the Jayhay has Josh and Bo Naylor, and you have
the best Naylor.
Yeah.
What they say. We got
some
the
people
best.
Are calling
do they?
That's
some
that's
people
what,
say that.
That's what they say. They say we got the best athlete.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I've heard that as well.
I mean, Bo Naylor is a pretty athletic catcher, man.
It never gets old to me thinking about, like, bro, Jay, just imagine if you woke up today and you and your brother could go have breakfast, and then you went and got coffee, and then you're on the way to the fucking stadium because you guys are big leaguers together and you're going to be hitting in the same lineup. You guys just went deep last week together in the same inning.
And we're checking in on our youngest brother to make sure that, like, the start to his professional career is
right.
Like,
is this little fucker got his shit together? Is he doing all right? Who are you talking about? Our little brother. Where's he at? Well, he's an A-ball. We're in the big leagues.
Dylan, talk to Brandon, man. He sucked ass last night. He went 0-for-5 with 4 Ks. Like, what's up with this dude, man?
Just so fucking cool.
Must be nice.
It would be cool.
It must be nice.
Are we moving on from that batch of games?
Do you have any nugs on that?
I just want to talk Cubs D-backs really fast.
So, yeah, go ahead.
Cubs bullpen's a potential disaster. I know their ERA is only like 4.5, but fourth highest walk rate in baseball. And last night was kind of tough. And Kyle Hendricks. Well, like I brought this up before, but like I'm gonna beat it because the stats are like just so eye popping. I think we all know watching Kyle Hendricks pitch that like the margin for error for him in the back half of his career was not very wide. And after his bad 2022, I think his good 2023 was in some ways a little bit, it was a surprise to me. I'll say that. But this start literally couldn't be worse. Few by the numbers, and then Dallas, I want your reaction. Highest ERA in baseball, worst WAP win probability added. And in terms of win probability added, he's like twice as bad as the next worst player, who's Patrick Corbin. He's allowed the most home runs of any qualified pitcher in baseball. Well, for the home runs, it's qualified or otherwise, but for the other ones, it's qualified. His ERA is about 4 runs higher than the next worst person, too. No one has allowed a higher batting average against righties, 410, and no one has allowed a higher OPS against lefties, 1.264. So doesn't matter who's up. His overall whiff rate's tied for the third lowest. His in-zone contact rate's tied for the third highest. And his sinker batters are now 18 for 35, which is a 514 batting average. And no pitcher has allowed more hits off of any single pitch than Hendricks has allowed off the sinker this season. I think he is done.
And Jayhay, I hate the fact that you and I are looking at the same shit. It doesn't surprise me that we are, but there were three things that I looked at. O contact, highest it's ever been in his career, which means should they start to expand their zone, this is no longer out of deception. This is simply because it looks good enough to them and they're going to fucking expand their zone and they're going to eat. And that's exactly what's been happening. Because the contact rate.
This is BP
rate,
stuff, man.
Oh, Jay, it's painful, man. It's painful. You guys know how much I fucking love a master manipulator. And that's who this dude has been. And he is not manipulating anything right now. The zone contact rate, highest it's ever been, 93%. The contact rate overall for Kyle Hendricks, 87%. The highest it's ever been. The home run to fly ball ratio. Are you ready for this? Last year, it was 15.6%. As we set today, it's 35%.
Dude, and this is over, April. This is April. Double. Think about July and Wrigley, man.
Over double. And it's, yeah, it sucks. It sucks because if you don't have the one weapon that can get guys off of all of your other shit, then you are dancing a dance with the devil. And the fact that he can subtract has been subtracted from what he does well now. And it's because the sinker is no longer the viable option to go to. 2-0, 2-1, 3-1. He can't just get that.
And you've led me directly to the last point I wanted to make, which was, I'm not going to throw, Dallas and I have thrown enough numbers at you, so I'm not going to do any more. But if you were to go onto Baseball Savant and look at his righty-lefty splits, I talked about the overall numbers, but what you'll find is that righties are crushing his, when you think of Kyle Hendricks, you think of primarily two pitches, or at least I do, sinker and changeup. The righties are crushing his sinker, and the lefties are annihilating his changeup for a lot of power, too, and a lot of home runs. Like, this is a guy who has no solutions for either side of the plate right now. And I know the Cubs are like living at large with Imanaga's start and stuff like that. But like Justin Steele's not there. Jameson Taillon's not there right now. And Kyle Hendricks would be better off not being there in terms of taking his next couple of starts. So like Cubs fine start given all the things they've been dealing with. But this is a huge issue for them now, or at least an issue that needs to be addressed.
Yeah. Outside of what Assad and Imanaga, there's a lot left to be desired.
And Steele's coming back and Taillon will come back. But like, that's also going to be a very, very competitive division this season.
I just don't want
the Pirates and Brewers look better than many thought, particularly the Brewers. I just don't think it's going to be an easy walk, and they need those guys.
Yeah, I just hate watching. I hate seeing this.
Yeah, it sucks.
I know that you got to go through it. I know you got to experience it. It is what it is. I just, you feel like you're watching a guy run out there, you know, fucking half naked. He just doesn't have the weapons that he had, and the weapons aren't what they were.
Yeah. And we saw it happen last year with Mad Bum. And yeah, we never heard like if there's one guy that was not going to announce his retirement, it's Madison Bumgarner. But it fell apart for him early, got released, never heard from him again. Like
Mad Bum's going to come back doing fucking Marlboro commercials when they let those commercials come. Like, he's just, that's where you're going to see him next.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't even smoke. I just wanted to ride my horse.
Hey, lefty. I wanted to, he's a scary dude. I wanted to continue the positivity that we've been spreading on the podcast today. Take a page out of Jay Hay's book here. I would like to acknowledge someone for a great accomplishment. Javy Báez, first walk of the season yesterday. He did it. He did it. He did it.
Were there any balls that reached the backstop during that at bat?
That's actually a great question.
Where were the pitches?
that's a great question. Absolutely. Because you know what that tells me? Is those were either the four shittiest sliders he has seen all season, or those were the four most errant fastballs he's seen all season. But I feel the same way about whoever that has walked Javy Báez. Who did that? Who's the asshole that walked Javy Báez? Because I'm the asshole who has walked Vladimir Guerrero in my lifetime, and I felt like that was fucking impossible to do. But after you look up, you're like, damn, there was nothing even close that fucking guy couldn't swing at. How did you do that?
Yeah, it was John Gray, for the record.
In a pretty solid start overall, outside of that embarrassing moment.
Yeah, the ball four was a slider down. Wow. It had like some vertical
break it dotted?
To it.
Javy probably just gave up, didn't even see it. It was like, oh, fuck, it's a ball.
Below the zone. So it's just, I mean, it was a good take for Javi's standards.
Yeah. With that, we're down to one qualified batter who has not walked this season.
Who's that?
Jose Caballero.
Ah.
On the Rays.
Okay. Javy Báez statistic update. He has 7 hits on the year, 6 singles, and 1 home run.
And how many punch-outs?
He has struck out 15 times.
One walk.
In 49 at-bats.
Let me take that one further, since we're doing like a little impromptu Báez segment.
So he will have punched. He will have punched out 100 times and walked 6.
Mm-hmm.
Is that good? His 374 OPS is the second worst among 188 qualified batters right now. The only worst player so far has been Victor Scott of the Cardinals, who somehow has a 288 OPS. Yeah.
Something to piggyback off a discussion that we had a few days ago. About the rivalries and where the Dodgers and Padres stand in the pantheon of all that.
Fine.
Had nearly 2 million viewers, Jayhay, on ESPN's Sunday Night Baseball. It was the most watched non-Red Sox-Yankees game in almost 6 years on the network, Jayhay.
Okay, that's fine. It can be a rivalry. I withdraw... I withdraw my previous statement. I don't live there. I don't have anything invested in it. And if they want to say that it is a full-blown rivalry, then I accept it.
In the air to right field. Towards the corner. It's back. It's gone. Welcome to Slam Diego.
Slam Diego, baby. Yeah, People are tuning in to watch it.
Giants fans. I think a lot of push comes from Giants fans. Feeling like, well, if the Padres and Dodgers are going to be a rivalry, then what the fuck does that leave us? What does that mean about us? Are we not competitive enough now? Like, did we go from being a division hopeful every year to now we're third place? We're not even we're the stepchild in this relationship. Like, how's that happen?
And I think, you know, again, I'll take the L. Like, whatever, it's a rivalry. I think I was holding that conversation to an unfairly high standard because, you know, when I was referencing like the A-Rod Veritek stuff, that was while both of the teams were very good, right? And championship caliber clubs. But those two were rivals for a long time leading up to that, where that was not the case. And, you know, other great, like Cubs Cardinals, nobody would question whether that is a longstanding traditional rivalry. And we all know that one of those teams went a long time without having any success, and one of them had a great deal of success for a very long time, and they were still rivals during that period. So that the Dodgers are basically always better and will always be better than the Padres moving forward shouldn't preclude that from being a rivalry necessarily. So congratulations, well, I was wrong.
What would you need? What would you need to have this violently shoved into rivalry territory for you? Because where it's, I mean, is that
somebody hit somebody?
Like, yeah. Is that legitimately? Is that all that's left? Like, all right, you know what?
I mean,
fuck it.
I yeah. think it's
it has to be stars. Like I want Mookie Betts and Manny Machado in a fist fight. Like, it's got to be. It can't just be like how, like, even when Pedro and Karim Garcia, like, who is Karim Garcia? It's like, all right, well, then he threw down Don Zimmer. Like, we know who that is. Like, I need star versus star violence in this.
Star versus star violence. Could you imagine if Fernando Tatis just hauled off and knocked the shit out of Mookie Betts and knocked his fedora off, like, post-game? Like, is that what you're looking for?
He just goes up to him in the interview room and just fucking flips his fedora off his head. And he's like, nice fedora, you fucking asshole. That would be cool. I would love that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that'd be awesome. I mean, yeah. I think it's okay to say that from like a national perspective, or like from a perspective of a person who is not living in San Diego or Los Angeles, that for both of the teams to be great would thrust it into like national visibility rivalry territory. Like, I think that's an okay standard to have from that perspective. But from the perspective of Padres and Dodgers fans, I think it's fine the way that it is, perhaps. Like,
the Dodgers Giants thing is just so rooted in bad blood for so long. That's where it comes from. And that's what I think we all sort of get attracted to, is that long-standing vile relationship. Like, oh, that's a rivalry. I mean, you know, and I hate to, like, fan bases, how they've, you know, I mean, we jokingly talk about the violence, like, oh, fighting on the field and shit, but let's not remember there was an incident between Dodgers and Giants fans, an individual by the name of Brian Stowe, who was Giants fan, who was beaten horrendous.
Yeah, certainly not what anybody's rooting for here. Yeah,
no, God, no. Yeah. So I understand the sense of Giants Dodgers, you know, that there's definitely layers to that don't exist between the Padres and Dodgers, but I can understand. That's why I asked, like, what are you waiting for, or what does the general public need?
Give me some legit, like, bad blood. It doesn't have to be a full blown brawl, but like, give me some like Bryce Harper was mouthing off to the Braves in the playoffs last year. Like, give me something like that. Like that, like they've played each other in the playoffs now. Like, you need playoff play against each other. You need heated competition, but you also need some bad blood. It doesn't have to be a full blown fist fight, but like people shit talking each other through the media. Like, we got a little bit of that. Like, you know, but I don't think that Will Smith and Jerks and Profar is going to reach the national audience. Like, right idea, wrong cast of characters.
But maybe, why not? Why not? If they continue to match up,
because
if they continue to see each other.
The whole idea of, like, hey, like, we don't throw, like, Jerks and Profar is kind of irrelevant. We weren't throwing at you. I'm like, that's a mean thing to say, but you're right.
And by the way, saying mean things like that, great seed to plant to get this thing moving forward too. I'm okay with saying mean things about bit players. If that's where we have to start, that's fine. But like, the other layer to this that is intriguing to me is, and I don't know the answer, but like, the Dodgers roster turnover has to factor into this somehow. Like, what is Shohei Ohtani's rivalry with the Padres? What is Freddie Freeman hasn't been there that long. Mookie Betts, like, okay, this is now season four or five that he's been with the Dodgers, but like, not a career long Dodger. Teoscar Hernandez just got there. What is Tyler Glasnow's problem with the San Diego Padres? What is Yamamoto's problem with the Dodgers? It's like, yes, we can generate some bad blood here. Hope maybe, but like, that the Dodgers go out and spend, which I'm not criticizing, and get star level players year in and year out, has to factor into the fact that like, that none of these guys have any pre-existing bad blood with this team.
No, it would be a faux rivalry, you know? because you do, you come up through the minor leagues playing against each other, and you know, you might have issues with guys as you matriculate through the system, you find yourself in the big leagues. But I'm a big believer that you have to have something taken away from you by this other team. You have to have been prevented to get to where you want to go consistently.
Yeah.
For that to really feel like, you know what? I don't care who your bat boy is. If I see him in the crosswalk, it's fucking, it's on. It's on sight.
And you know what? If Will Smith and Profar and, you know, maybe Chris Taylor and Kike have to get involved, and, you know, if they got to carry it for a little bit while these other guys get their feet wet in Dodger blue, then that's fine.
I'm with it. I'm with it.
One quick note on the Padres before we move on from that. Dylan Cease. Yesterday, 6 innings, 2 hits, 1 earned run. He did walk 5, but he struck out 7. Skip came to get him towards the end of his outing, and then he was like, he did the old Mike Mussina, like, you stay in there. And then he stayed in the game, ended up punching out the guy. And yeah, so his ERA through 4 starts after his last 2, where he's allowed 1 earned run in 12 innings, has dipped under 2. He's got a 1.99. To go along with a 289 FIP. So we know that that's not crazy.
Not hokey.
Sustainable. But yeah, Dylan Cease, San Diego Padre. Staying within the National League here.
Oh,
are
fuck.
They back?
Get the fuck out of here.
I don't know, Dallas.
Fuckery.
I don't know. Dallas. Fuckery. Hey, 4 straight series wins.
Whatever.
For your New York Metropolitans. Started off 0-5. Kevin Clancy wanted to cancel the season. I think that was a little premature of him to do that. Because your New York Metropolitans have battled back in the NL East to a 9-8 record. They're only 2.5 games back. 3 straight victories, 4 straight series victories for your New York Mets. You dig into the numbers here. Pedro Alonso, this is the last 9 games here. An 1193 OPS for him. An 854 OPS for Brandon Nimmo, 783 OPS for Jeff McNeil, but he's hitting 300. Harrison Bader hitting 346 over this stretch, but then you look at the OPS, it's 777. Starling Marte hitting 300 with a 749 OPS. Brett Beatty, 313, 697 OPS. But they've got some guys that are they're doing it offensively. I know on the pitching side of things. I mean, like, you've got 1 start for Luis Severino that was good. Quintana's been okay. But yeah, I think it's been largely, the season's been brought back to life by Pedro Alonso.
Okay, so Kevin canceling the season is one thing. All right, if we want to say that is premature because this team isn't a White Sox level terrible, that is certainly a viable response to that action. But I think our point on this podcast was that this team is fundamentally blah and it is not very interesting. And like, I'm going to hold firm on that one. 9-8 with a bunch of guys hitting 350 over that stretch is what it is. Like, that this team could win 78 to 84 games, I don't think is particularly surprising. My existential concern with the Mets isn't whether the most optimistic Mets fans are able to squeeze some enjoyment out of this season. I got into a texting exchange with a guy I used to know who's a hardcore Mets fan, one of the most optimistic sports fans I've ever been around. And he's like, yeah, it was canceled too early. Like, I was listening. And I'm like, that's fine. I hope you enjoy the season. My concern, though, is that where is this all going? What does this lead to for the Mets in 2025 and 2026? Because the guy that Jared started off the positivity train on is Pete Alonso. What is his contract status?
They're going to have to make a decision. Yep.
They are going to have to make a decision on him. And I think either decision is very difficult because if you trade the guy who is playing the best and who may be assuming Lindor gets back on track, is probably your second best overall player.
You have no power.
then you have no power and you have a gaping hole in your lineup. And then what is your timeline and what are you doing around Lindor? And are you going to be competitive in 2025? If you sign Pete Alonso to a $200+ million contract, what does the second half of that deal look like? That is a nauseating potential deal to have to eat on the back half. So like, and even if you bring Alonso back, like what is this all building to? I don't know. Like they're not the worst team in the league. They're not in the worst situation. I just think they're not going anywhere real with this pitching staff. Is anybody disagreeing with that at this point?
No. Nope. Not at all. Not at all.
We're talking playoffs? We're talking winning record? What are we talking about?
Do you think they can be like meaningfully different than a 500 team with this rotation?
No, I could give them, I would give them right at like what we're talking fucking 82 and 80.
Yeah, I think this is a 78 to 84 win team. And I don't think that has changed much since the start of the season. And they're 9-8. So it's not, they're not like crazy. They're, right, they're not off that projection by much, if any. So yeah.
Adrian Hauser doesn't do it for you?
No. These guys are all
Sean
like,
Manaea has not pitched well.
It's not like these are not major league pitchers. They're just not the pitching staff 1 through 5 of a team that's going to do, that's A, I think going, A, has no chance to do any real damage. And B, I think on a more relevant level for 2024, I just don't see how this rotation makes it through a season. Like,
and remember what the messaging was. Remember why Max Scherzer is now hanging his hat in Texas. Remember, because they weren't supposed to be competitive. They weren't really thinking about being competitive this year. They were maybe going to entertain the thought in 2025. And then from there, we'll kind of see how it goes. That's on the record. That is a fact. So that just gives you an outline of where the Mets think they were heading, where they felt like they were heading a year ago. And I agree. Quintana throwing the ball well. Don't know if that's viable all year long. And the same could be said for anybody else who's throwing the ball well. Severino, right? As we talked, Manaea, not great right now. Outside of the guy that you're getting love from in the bullpen, what does that look like? This team is not interesting in any way, I don't think.
I wouldn't say they're not interesting. They're just not, to Jay Hayes' point in the question, I don't envision them going anywhere.
Well, that's what I what intrigues you? What intrigues you? Like the most like intriguing thing is whether or not you're going to keep your power hitting first baseman. Like that's
The most intriguing thing is, I get that, you know, the Max Scherzer point is valid. He was told that they're not going for it this year. I get all that, but are still some very good players on this team.
Yes.
Well, like, there's no denying that, but I'm asking, like, so are you intrigued? Like, does that excite you, what Lindor could bring to the table? Let's say he has a fucking top 10 MVP caliber season. You excited about that? Going.
He hasn't done dick. Yeah.
Well, okay. So Pete Alonso, let's say he's going to lead the league in homers again. What does that do for him? I think that just makes the decision that Jayhay and I are talking about the most intriguing thing about this team.
Yeah.
That's,
and I think, like, unless you are a Mets fan, which again is kind of a separate but related conversation, to me, a team in transition, which is what this team is, a veteran heavy, or at least a veteran filled.
Late.
Yeah. A team in transition like this is the least interesting team to follow for me over the course of a 162 game season. They are not a great team, so I'm not tuning in and getting to watch great players every night. And they are not a team on the rise, like, let's say, the Royals or the Tigers or the Pirates or something like that, where I can be tuning in and I'm seeing, oh, you know, Jared Jones is starting tonight. You know, like, I'm going to get to see him on the bump and I'm going to get to see O'Neill Cruz do his thing on the other side. Like, that on my end is, like, interesting, right? There is an interest level to that, the raise it, lower it stuff aside. You could make similar cases for, like, Bobby Witt and Cole Reagans and stuff like that in different combinations. The Mets just
Reed Garrett.
Uh-huh. And there's no Paul and there's no Paul Skeens like on the horizon, right? So it's like, to the point about where is this all going, It's a team that's prioritizing 2025 without necessarily a talent base that suggests that it's going to flower in 2025, right? Or I need more direction on where this is going before I can be like really, really interested in the Mets. And it's not like anything personal against the Mets. When they are good, I am very interested. I tune in for as many Mets games as I do any other team when the Mets are good. I love the broadcast. I love all that stuff. Like, and that championship window that slammed shut, that's what I'm comparing it to, I guess, is like we were, it feels like moments ago, this team was a 100 win team and now it's a different direction and it's less interesting than that. And that's fine. But that doesn't mean that we need to pretend that that a 9-8 start is more than kind of what it is. Positivity train.
I did hear you mention one name, Jayhay.
Yeah.
That name was Jared Jones.
Oh, buddy.
And he went five
scoreless. Shot.
One hit, Dallas. He hasn't issued a walk since his first start of the season when he punched out 10. He added 7 more strikeouts to the tally. That makes it 32 strikeouts in 23 innings. What do you like from Jared Jones, Dallas?
You like everything from Jared Jones. You like everything about Jared Jones. Jayhay, you talk about watching teams. You talk about the excitement of the growth and what it could look like. This is a guy who gives you those kinds of feelings. There's a lot of guys, I think, on this team that can give you those kinds of feelings. But Jared Jones is a guy you start to think about, what does the future of our rotation look like? What does the future of our personality as a staff look like? There's a lot of fuck you in this dude just waiting to bubble over. And I feel like as you start to get guys that are knocking on the door, and they start to get comfortable together as well. They start to get to the big leagues together. They start to have success in the big leagues together. Shit starts to get scary for the competition. Scary. Right. And I want to believe that Jared Jones is going to be a big, 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 big part of that.
Mm-hmm. Bet your ass he is. Raise it. Anyone want to show some love for Ranger Suarez? Complete game shot piece last night.
CG shot piece. Do it, Les.
Yeah.
I mean, first one by a Phillies lefty since he did it 3 seasons ago.
Wow.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Yep. I mean, how many Phillies lefties have there been?
Lefties.
But, even if you don't make it lefty or righty, I think they only had 1 complete game by their whole staff last year. So, or complete game shutout. So, very, very impressive.
And by the way, go ahead.
Yeah, I want to go back to Jared Jones too. So
thank
go ahead.
You.
Please.
Well, that's exactly where I was going. Like, I just, just looking at some of the Savant numbers. Saddle up, bitch. I mean, the chase rate, 98th percentile, whiff rate, 97th percentile, K rate, 94th percentile, the walk rate, Jared highlighted, 95th percentile. Barrel percentage, 10%. Hard hit rate, 13%. there's a lot to love about this dude. There is a lot to love about this dude. And I think my biggest thing is the poise and the presence at his age. Because how old is he? Fucking 22? 23? He's a fucking baby. He's a baby. But like I said, you can just tell that there is a certain moxie there. That is going to play. That's going to be a big part of what he does.
A couple of notes just to tack on to Jared Jones. Fangraphs has a stat which is not super complicated. It's just strikeout rate minus walk rate to give you a sense of, you know, the best combination. He has the second best of any qualified pitcher in baseball to the points you guys have just made behind only Freddy Peralta. Highest game score in an outing of 5 innings pitched or fewer. By a Pirates pitcher in 28 years. Francisco Cordova in 1996 was the last time somebody had an outing of 5 or fewer that was basically this impressive. So I know they're babying him a little. They're watching him. even though, as you said, like with the way he's slicing and dicing people, it's not like it's necessarily super high effort. But well, I shouldn't say high effort. It's not. It has not been super stressful.
Laborious.
Yeah. In that regard, but I just incredibly impressive. I mean, to me, he is in a lot of ways, like in terms of individual players, he's on the short list for stories of the season. Because, well, like, I know he was a high end prospect, and I know people had really high expectations for him. But this, you're not convincing me that this was the expectation immediately upon arrival.
No,
and this is what it is. And is my point. Yeah,
yeah. No, and the fact that he's doing it, like, I don't want to say with virtually just two pitches, but I mean, it's heavy fastball, heavy slider usage. They'll throw a curveball at you here and there, a little changeup piece, but. I mean, it's you look at some of the maps too, and it's fucking just dotted. He's got an incredible feel for the secondary pitch. It's why it's a weapon. It's why it is the weapon that it is. He's a lot of fun, man. He's a lot of fun to watch. Like I'm not gonna call him. I'm not gonna throw the appointment TV title on him, but it's fun.
Not to pivot away from Major League Baseball, but I feel like we have to mention Jac Caglianone.
Caglianone just dropping diesel, chucking flame.
He has hit a home run in seven straight games for the Florida Gators, and the most recent one, 516 feet, and he's a pitcher.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Potential Golden Spikes watch.
Yeah.
Do they have him on the Golden Spikes watch? I didn't think they did.
I mean, how do you not?
Well, because I just didn't think that he was. I mean, he's on a tear right now. I just thought that there were some other guys across the country that were doing things, but he's nasty. He's going to be, I gotta believe he goes as a pitcher.
I mean, there's dudes, what was it? Eldridge last year in the draft was a two-way guy. I think he got taken as one. He went with the Giants, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
How do you not see seven straight home runs, one that goes 516 feet, and a dude that can shove on the mound and be like, I'm not going to ask him to pick one, are you?
Yeah, I mean, that stuff, I think, always naturally shakes itself out.
Yeah, the game really will tell you.
Yep. The game will tell you. He will tell you in terms of, yeah, you know what? Like preparing to do this every day is just a little more comfortable. I feel like I respond to this a little better. And production wise, this might be the way to go.
Yeah. Longest home run measured by StatCast, Nomar Mazara hit a home run 505 feet in June of 2019. This ball traveled 516 feet. Obviously, it's aluminum bat, but I mean, Jesus Christ.
That's a fucking rod.
Yeah. I think the last thing that I had here, unless you guys had something else, was some acknowledgement for Jon Sterling's career.
Yep, that's all I had left.
Mm-hmm. Jon Sterling, legend with the pipes. What?
I was just gonna say it'll be weird. You know, it's not like it's gonna be tough and heartbreaking. I'm not gonna be able to get through. It'll be weird. Going to the ballpark and not seeing him there, not talking to him, because you walk into, because I'm great friends with Susan Waldman and I love hanging out with her when I go to the ballpark and talking to her, chopping it up, love lunch, just hang out in the booth and shit for a while. And obviously John's a part of that. And he's just he's a mainstay, the fucking voice of the Yankees for 35 years. You're not just some fucking bum in some studio. Like, you are Jon Sterling, dude. Jon Sterling. And I love, and I heard this conversation, like, does the next person in there, what do you try to pay homage to Sterling with some of the calls? Do you try to? No, absolutely not. And for the people who are like, he was corny at the end, he was, you know what, man? That's all part of a guy loving his job to the extent that he did, that he didn't give a fuck what you had to say. He didn't care that you thought it was corny. He doesn't care. Did not care. He did his job and he did it well for a very, very long time. And deserves the respect of doing that job as well as he did for as long as he did it. So I love everything that Jon Sterling has brought to the table for Yankees fans over 35 years in his profession. And I think if you've had the opportunity to be in his orbit and just have a conversation, whether it's 5 minutes or for an extended period of time, you probably value that. You probably remember that.
I agree with all that. I do think that towards the end in particular, the corniness was being leaned into. And I think that's a part that should be embraced. And I know that, like, I didn't grow up in New York or in Connecticut for that matter. But I remember when I moved back east in 2008 and, like, all of the driving that I did around the East Coast at that time. And, like, I remember turning on the radio and listening to the Yankee games and being like, going from what the hell is going on here? You know what I mean? In that broadcast booth to making sure that if I had a drive coming up and there was a baseball game available, that I was seeking out that broadcast booth above other ones to be able to listen to it. And that wasn't as a Yankees fan, obviously. That was just someone who was looking for a level of entertainment. And to me, like, that's the greatest compliment that you can pay a broadcast booth, is that you are going out of your way to some extent to pursue their version of the entertainment of baseball. So I will also miss him in a kind of, later this summer, I'll be turning on the radio and be looking for the Yankee game, and it'll be Susan and somebody else. And I'll be like, well, this just isn't quite as good. Whoever takes that spot.
We're going to Cleveland, Jayhay. And then right after that, we're going to New York. And, like, I had already texted with Susan. And now, like, the news came out. And, fuck, man. That sucks.
Yeah. No call more entertaining.
Drill, there goes. Deep left, it is high. It is far. That is God out of the ballpark. A Stantonian home run. Now, what did I do wrong? What did I see wrong? He's at first base.
Oh, man. Jon Sterling. Absolute legend. That's what I tweet. I said, we throw around the word legend a lot, but Jon Sterling's a legend in every sense of the word.
Yes, he is.
If you had the chance to listen to him throughout your baseball fandom, his voice, you'll be able to call back and hear it in your head whenever you want. Bob Shepard is someone that, you know, if you're a Yankee fan growing up, it's number like two. That's the voice of Yankee Stadium. And it's like Jon Sterling, that is the voice of summers for Yankee fans all over the world. So
I know people were having fun. I think MLB asked for your best Jon Sterling calls, and some of the most viral things were quote tweets of what Jared did, or, like, you know, the one where the ball was actually caught at the wall on a stand. Yeah.
Swung on, there it goes. Deep left center. That ball is high. It is far. It is gone.
And caught.
But caught.
and I am right there along with that. But I would invite anybody who ever has the opportunity to go sit in the broadcast booth where those guys are doing that job, or TV for that matter, and think of the instant amount of time that you need to make a decision on whether you're doing a home run call when a ball is hit like that, or whether you're going to lay out and it's going to be weird when the ball's a home run. And think about how many years and how many games that dude broadcasted, and that there are only whatever, 6-10 of those clips available is actually super impressive in a lot of ways.
They all came when he was in his mid-80s.
Yeah. Like, oh yeah, so some 80-year-old guy's having trouble picking up, like, the exact flight of the home run from, like, fucking 1,000 feet away from the wall. Yeah. Like, okay. And, like, a mile up.
You had 65-year-old people in the ballpark who can't keep up with the pitch clock today. They're like, hold on.
Every time I go to a game, I misjudge a fly ball just in the stands. I'm like, I got that one wrong. It's like, that would have been a bad call if I was being paid to announce right now.
Mm-hmm.
Every game.
Yep. Yep. You're like, oh. All right. Jake's takes.
I think John should lean into some of the funny calls towards the end of his career and just, like, If he dropped a t-shirt that said gone but caught, I would buy that in a second.
Oh, yeah, God.
I'd wear that.
That'd be a hot selling item.
But caught.
Now, what did I do wrong? What did I see wrong?
and you can see him just listening to that. I can see him in his booth just like looking over at Susan going like, no, what?
Now, that ball went over the fence, but he's at first base.
What did I do wrong? What is
make it make what? Sense. That's not the rule.
Susan, that is not baseball.
Yeah. Jayhay, any final thoughts today?
Yeah, I mean, I guess as long as we're doing the announcer thing, this segues nicely. I was watching the Tigers-Rangers game yesterday afternoon, and I just, like, Tigers are a team on the come up. I was watching the same thing
you were watching.
Yeah, the Tigers are a team on the come up, and the White Sox are depressing. But, like, that's only further exacerbated by the fact that Jason Benetti is now working for the Tigers. And I was watching that game. I was paying pretty close attention. And in the eighth inning, they had a relief pitcher substitution, pinch hitter dynamic going on that Jason Benetti broke down better than I have ever heard an announcer, and I don't listen to every game of every broadcast, but like that I've ever heard anybody break down on the fly in my life. And it was for a guy in his first season on that team, which I do think has to matter in some way in terms of familiarity to make it even more impressive is my point. And it was just like, I understand what's happening. I understand the implications. I understand the decisions. And now I'm going to watch it play out. And it played out in a way that made what Benetti said really, really sound even more like
prescient.
Intelligent and prescient. Yeah. And just having listened to the Tigers booth in previous years, where it was without question, Dallas, you don't need to respond to this, was without question a bottom tier booth. It is in such great shape right now. And I just wanted to say that while we were on that topic.
Dallas, final thoughts?
My final thoughts were going to be with
Sterling.
About Jon Sterling.
Cool. All right. We'll be back tomorrow to look ahead to this weekend's slate, break down anything crazy that happens tonight in the world of baseball. Thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. And just as a reminder, you know, we're like, what, 3 weeks into having a new feed? I know you have friends that watch baseball. If they don't listen or watch The Baseball Is Dead, tell them about us. Mm-hmm. Just be like, hey, you love baseball? You play fantasy baseball? You watch it and then you go manage a team that isn't real? You probably like this podcast. Do us a solid. Be like, hey, come check out Baseball Is Dead. I think you really like it. That would go a long way.
And go
shout out to the Grave Diggers.
Yeah, go check out the YouTube channel because Jayhay's got the Jayhay's got some essays pumping in the works.
Those so I got a little sneak peek at the script for both of them. I'm sorry, Joe, but there's a new sheriff in town. As far as baseball video essays go, your time is up, pal. I feel like Jayhay just it's like Joe's BlackBerry and Jayhay's the iPhone. It's just, man, how do we compete with this? You can't.
After this call, I'm going to do a feedback session with Jake and Jeremy. So now that I'm high, I'm ready to be brought back down. But yeah, thank you. I'm excited about all of that, and I'm excited to get that out there into the world. So we'll see.
Imagine if like we have like a YouTube channel and it's like we have like the podcast on there is just kind of like a side feature, and Jayhay's video essays are what gets like 6 million views every time. Podcast gets like 10K, 15K, and then like Jayhay puts out a video essay. 3.7 million? Jesus Christ.
That would be fine. I'll never forget about you guys. You guys are, I will take care of you for sure.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate that.
We will also have the grounds, I don't know if I should tell, I'm going to wait till the series is, well, it's not going to be wrapped per se, but we got a great series coming your way with interviews from the head groundskeepers across baseball.
Okay.
So stay tuned for that as well. That's been going very nicely.
Okay. Very excited for that as well. All right. We'll be back tomorrow. See you then. Love you guys. Bye.
We out.